Hi, Ford again. Welcome to episode 4 of the Great British Ginko Leaf Inlay class. Before we proceed with the contents of episode 4, it's come to my attention that perhaps in the previous episodes I haven't been quite as clear or haven't emphasized the thickness of the material for this project, or indeed really discussed the thickness of ground material for inlay work. So I want to talk about that before we proceed, so that I can mention it in the descriptions of the previous films. So in this instance, for this exercise, I'm using 1.2 millimeter copper. So 1.2 millimeter copper is what I use in class. And it's that extra 0.2 gives us just enough extra material to work with. When inlaying into materials like copper, you do have a little bit of a safety in a sense, in that the copper itself is quite malleable and it stretches. So when you're pushing with your punches to create the lip that will hold the inlay later, if you are going too deep, what happens is you'll see the metal being stretched on the underside. In fact, it is quite difficult to punch through the metal. When I was doing a lot of restoration work of Meiji period pieces, I frequently worked on large silver presentation vases, the imperial presentation vases, which are pure silver, which is, if you work pure silver, will know, it's even softer than copper. And the base metal that the vases were forged out of, it must have started off around about 1 mil, but by the time it was finished, it was under a mil. And into that, they'd inlaid whatever decoration was required. So it's perfectly possible, depending on your skill level and the delicacy of your technique, to inlay into material that's less than a millimeter. Let's say 0.9 was seemed to be typical. But that does mean you have to be ever so careful, and there really is very little room to make any mistakes with. As a general guide, I would suggest starting out that your inlay piece, your mongane, is your guide. So if you've got a piece of metal that you want to inlay and you want to carve this, and you know, well, I need about a millimeter of metal to carve to get a nice height, some detail and volume on your ginkgo leaf or your tiger or whatever it is you've inlaid, you've got to then allow for about the same amount of metal in the ground. If you were going to go further and say, okay, I want 4 millimeters above the ground, you wouldn't have to have 4 millimeters in the ground to hold it. But you need at least something that's going to secure it. So again, it's very hard to have hard and fast exact tables of thicknesses and relative numbers that you could compare. But to start off with, when we're working with these relatively shallow inlays, I would say about half of the metal needs to be in the ground. And for our purposes, 1.2 is good. If it's thicker, of course, that's fine. It's not going to be a problem. But that's where we're at with inlay work and the materials. You'll remember at the end of episode 3, we'd forged up the Shibuichi ingot. And although I'd said at the start I was expecting some cracks to appear from the end where the metal had cast, in fact, none had appeared. This, of course, was due to two things. One, the annealing process was very effective, and the other was the result of forging. I don't think I explained really adequately or thoroughly enough how forging allows us to work sort of homemade alloys like this a little bit more effectively than a rolling mill. So I'm going to talk about that in a moment. But now that we've got the camera zoomed in really up close on this crack, I want to talk about this. So what I did once I'd finished, I didn't anneal the piece. So that ingot had been reduced down by 50%, so it had gone from 5 mil as cast down to 2.5 millimeters. I then decided, after we finished filming, to put it through the rolling mill. Now, the rolling mill, for those of you who haven't seen one, and I will demonstrate it in a moment, is a bit like a mangle, old-fashioned mangle, and it just squeezes the metal through between two rollers. The consequence, of course, is that it gets thinner, but all of the pressure is in one direction, and it builds up. So the pressure starts on the leading edge as you feed the metal in, and it squeezes, squeezes, squeezes. So any pressure and tension is building up behind the roller. So as I started here, the pressure built up, and almost immediately, because I hadn't annealed this, so this was at its maximum forging, and I put it through, and I think it was the second pass, I reduced it by an eighth of a turn. So it's a tiny amount of reduction, but I'd obviously reached the limits. And then putting all of the pressure in one straight line, it just cracked neatly like that. I sort of expected it to happen, and in a sense, there was part of me being quite destructive about it to see how far it would go. But what it allows us to illustrate is, in fact, the structure of the metal. So you can see inside the crack here, this very strong crystalline structure. When the metal was cast, those grains were much bigger. And so through forging, they've broken down. And that's, of course, what we want. The finer the crystalline structure in the metal, the more reliably it will work. We haven't got great big voids and large chunks that may crack apart. What we did get because of the pressure is there was, as I predicted, this was the end that was exposed when we cast it into the mold. And if, you know, I put that into the rolling mill, so the pressure started here. It found a weak spot, and that crack ran along. All the pressure was relieved, a bit like an earthquake, along this line, exposing the metal. Now, this happens in a rolling mill. If you're forging, what you're doing is you're distributing the pressure back and forth. So it's offsetting all the time. You're not getting a linear buildup of pressure. So the rolling mill was the final straw for this poor piece of metal. I'm going to anneal it now, and I'm going to do one more thing because I want to put it through the rolling mill a little bit more, just to illustrate how a rolling mill works. I'm fairly confident once it's annealed, and I've done one thing to stop the crack, we can go further. So the crack terminates about here. If I were to anneal it, which is to say to relieve all the stresses and put it in the rolling mill, it'll still simply continue to crack. Right from the beginning, I've no doubt at all that that crack will still, it'll continue to propagate. However, if I drill a hole here at the end, effectively cutting off that crack, I can anneal it, and then I believe I can safely continue rolling without any crack starting beyond. Because beyond this crack, there's nothing down here. There's the potential for a crack to develop, but it doesn't exist as yet. So if I cut that out, effectively stopping any further communication, if you like, of this crack with the crystals ahead, there's no link between this crack and what's over here if I drill a hole here. So I'm going to drill a hole at the end, and as paradoxical as it might seem, by drilling a hole in the metal, I stop the crack from continuing. So that's what I'm going to do now. I'll drill the hole, anneal it, pickle it to clean off the oxides, and roll it a little bit further, and then we'll get to cutting out that ginkgo leaf. So I've drilled the hole at the end of the crack and turned it over and realize that the crack actually is at an angle. So on this side, I haven't terminated the crack. So rather than drilling another hole, I'm simply going to use my saw frame and cut that out as well. So it's worth obviously checking that. Interesting little feature that I might have missed had I not checked the other side. And then of course the crack would have carried on that side. So I shall cut that out now before we proceed. Right, that should do the trick. So there we are. Shibuichi's now been pickled. I've given this a light rub with emery paper just to clean it up so we can see a little bit more clearly. This is a rolling mill. I've mentioned it a few times. So for those of you who are unfamiliar with rolling mills, as I said, it's a bit like a mangle, old-fashioned mangle for washing clothes. These are hardened rollers. This handle, if I turn it, it brings them closer together or further apart, depending on what I want. It's a gearbox here, so I turn the handle and the amount of effort I use is magnified and I can squeeze the metal through there. So first of all, I'm going to put the metal between the rollers and close it up on the metal. So now it's comfortably in the roller, I can roll it out. I'm just going to turn it a little bit and starting from the non-cracked end, roll it through. You can see how all the pressure is building up as it goes through. I'll do another little turn. And what I'm doing here is I'm just bringing the metal down very gradually. You can see it's very little effort for me. The gearbox is working fine. And as I'm going through, this is opening up further and more, further, but the crack doesn't appear to be developing. So a little stop gap. Huh, maybe that's where the term comes from. My stop gap has worked. Right, I'm going to measure it and I'm at just a touch over 2.1. I wanted it 2 mil, so I'll keep going a little longer. So now I'm going to go through ever so slightly at an angle, start flattening out the plate. This is generally not good practice to change direction a lot when you're rolling. But I'm doing it now, I'm not really reducing the metal anymore. I'm just doing this to flatten the plate. So by going across, I'm achieving a slightly flatter plate. I think that's pretty much where I need to be. There we are, down to 2 millimeters. So for the purposes of this exercise, 2 millimeters will do admirably. Shibuichi is now 2 mm thick, as we said. This is the template I'm going to use. Now I need to draw around it with a scriber very accurately. You can hold it in place with your finger. Sometimes what I find is useful is a little clamp. So I'm going to use a clamp here. Obviously where the clamp sits, I won't be able to draw. But then what I'll do is I'll move the clamp. So very carefully scribe around. This is just one of those skills you have to develop very carefully. The accuracy of your work, of course, depends on your scribing and this step, of course, is the very beginning, so worthwhile trying to get it really nice and neat and accurate. I'm not a big fan of covering things in paint or marker pen and so forth. I find it often is just a bit too messy. So I'll move the clamp very carefully to the other side and carry on with the scribing. So yeah, I'm not a big fan of using paint or ink to help scribe lines show out. I'd rather the metal was nice and clean. That way I can see the scribe lines more directly. Okay, I think that will do. So we have a nice shiny scribed outline. And now I shall cut it out with a jeweler's saw. It's a 3-0 saw blade I'm using, and
tuned to an F sharp.
Eh?
Tuned to an F sharp.
Tuned to an F sharp. Yeah, this is the optimum note. So it's important to have the light so you can see what you're doing. I tend to saw so that I can see on the side of the blade that's up against the piece I'm cutting, so I can see clearly whether or not I touch the line. So I'm aiming to just skim the edge of the line, nice and steady. Really important that the piece is kept steady. A little tip here. When cutting a curve like that, it's a bit like driving a car. You've actually got to anticipate the curve up ahead, and so you're trying to allow the blade to find its own way. If you try to turn too abruptly, what often happens is the blade gets twisted in such a way that it wants to go back against where you're trying to make it go. So you can't force a blade to turn into a curve unnaturally. You've got to allow it to find its own route. So it's really important to think ahead of the curve and allow the blade to make its own way. You really can't force it. I think this is the secret. And your attention really needs to be on the cutting edge. At the same time, you've got to be aware of where you're headed. that little flat of the blade, that little rectangle cross section, is part of a greater curve. No, I'm just going to continue to the edge and get rid of this excess material. I can deal with the rest of the leaf. I'm not going to try and do it all in one go. More often than not, blades break when you're moving the tools around rather than when you're working with them. Followed the lines. I'm not overly concerned about it being the most perfect of sawing out jobs. This is really just to illustrate cutting out, and I'm now going to file it up in preparation for the inlay. I suppose what we ought to do at some point is do a specific film on how to use a saw frame or the saw really accurately. If I can figure out how to do that. We could do that film at some point. Let's see what happens here. So I tore that apart. You can see it took quite a lot of tearing. Which illustrates, I think, the amount of tearing required to shear that. I think it illustrates quite well that the crack simply wasn't there anymore. Right, so I'm just filing up. What I'm doing here is I'm just making pleasing lines. There's, in the description below, a link to the film I mentioned earlier on, the use of the half-round file and half-round needle files in shaping up exactly one of these. So it's a very detailed, it's close to an hour-long film of this part of the exercise. So I'll direct you there. But you're more than welcome to peer over my shoulder here while I make this one. I don't think there's much to add. I think the commentary on the other form, because it is specific to the use of these files and this shape. I chose this ginkgo leaf shape so that it would serve as an exercise in filing. And you'll notice the different techniques for using files. I'm using this file very different from how an engineer would use a file on a piece of metal in a vise. You'll notice my file is remaining in contact with the piece. And I'm changing the direction, the angle. If I use the file so, I'm reliant on that radius. But if I turn it at an angle, I have a much broader radius. As I say, I describe all of this in much more detail in the film. describing the use of half round files. You might want to note how I'm holding the pieces, the piece rather, to keep things stable, to enable me to work more accurately, more efficiently. Work holding is really important. It's a major advantage to be able to keep your work stable while working. It's wobbling about, of course, it's a bit like too many variables if it keeps wobbling. Notice how I'm flipping back and forth from the flat side of the half round to the curved side. And using different areas, you use just the tip, then it's a bit like a needle file. Come back to the broad side and it's a very versatile file once you realize what all the aspects or areas of the file are for. So it's a little bit small there. So at that point, I revert or move over to a half round needle file. I complete that. I shall do this one as well. Notice I'm just filing vertical now. I'm not trying to put a curve or a bevel on these inlay pieces. That comes later. We've got this little bit here. I need to feather that in, make a nice form. As I say, the actual approach I use is detailed much more carefully in the half round file film. Quickly emery the upper surface so I know what the top is, and then I'm going to start doing the bevel. So I've cut out the piece and the walls are vertical, they're 90 degrees, so they're effectively 90 degrees. Clearly if I tried to inlay that, there'd be no locking of the edges. So what we do is we have to put a bevel on these sides. This larger wooden model hopefully illustrates that. So there we have 90 degrees, and you can see a slight angle, and that's what we're looking for. And that angle has to be all around the piece, all the way around, particularly on the tips of things. So at 10 degrees seems to be reasonable. The Ginko leaf now has, as I said earlier, the edges, the walls, are 90 degrees. And here we can see on the curved base plate it's going to be inlaid into, there's a gap. So the next step is to give this, the mongane, this little ginkgo leaf, a bit of a curve so it sits more closely on this curve. And it's important to do that before we file the bevels in. Because you can imagine if the bevels were there and then we curved it, we'd be losing the bevels as it bent over. With this leaf, it's mainly the body that needs some curvature. The tail, the stem rather, is so delicate, it really, we needn't be too concerned about trying to twist that. In fact, I'm not going to really focus on that because it is so delicate. So I'm just really going to put some curvature across this piece. Now, you can use it in a, you can do it in a block of lead, which would be sort of fairly traditional in a European goldsmith's tradition. A piece of wood is an alternative. I've mentioned a few times I like having blocks of beech wood around. I'm not going to carve a particular shape at this point. I also have some old brass bowls I sometimes use. But I'm going to use this because you probably don't have anything more specific. You could also use just a piece of soft pine and not bother shaping it. Just put your piece of shibuichi on the pine, and then using a hard wooden punch or a metal punch, if that's all you've got, tap it in because the pine will give way. But I'm going to use this curve here. I'm just going to use the mallet to impart a bit of a curve. It's quite a thick piece of metal, so it's going to take a bit of a belt, but enough to give me something to go with. Right, as you can see, that's quite a lot of curve, more than we need. But if I hold it flat, I think that gives me what I need. I can now adjust this a little bit by tapping on the top here. Don't want to mess up the tail or the stem. It's one of those areas you have to fiddle a bit, but I think that works pretty good. There we go. Now, making use of the nice curve of the half round, I can sweep through and put my bevel on everything. You notice what I did. I did one area, got that angle dead right, came off that, did the next bit, and used that as the guide for the next piece. So each piece of work then forms the guide for the following bit. I don't move on until I've established a good guide. It's not a matter of nibbling away here and there. Thank you.
Okay, and I should come on this side. Right, so I've established that plane, and I can come back here.
So this area, although it's at an angle, it needs to be flat. It's really important that it's flat, particularly at the bottom where it's going to lock in. It's a bit like a dovetail joint into wood. And it's the same all along.
Blend them in. Flip it round because it's awkward to work the other way now. And now, whereas here I was using the curve of the half round, now I'm going to use the flat as I come out, to be careful to make that transition nice. There's a little notch there, I can lock it in there, hold it nice and steady. Or try and hold it nice and steady. Transition. And go to the tail end. Put the other one there. So I've got a little bevel, got the angle I want, just move it around. Angle goes around the tip. And there you go. Right. Go to that level. Okay. Now we've got these little wrinkles at the top here. Let's see if this will work. I don't know if it will, so I'm going to work on the outside. I put the bevel there. The little dips, of course, haven't been touched. And that's fine. So now I'm going to take a needle file and come into the dip and follow the corresponding curve. The other side here. Now, because a needle file is thin, narrow at the tip, wide at the back, if I keep going here, there's a risk that I'll have more of a curve at the top than the bottom, so I'm going to turn it round and come from the bottom, maintaining the angle I had that I've established with the broad flats here, maintaining that angle. A little tricky to hold now, so I'm going against it, but no, maybe I'll turn it around. You've got to be careful to try and maintain the shape there. Just hack away. You do have an outline under here, remember? That's your pattern. That's what I'm working to. Trying to fab these in. Using my fingers quite a lot to act as a guide or as a stop to stop the needle file digging in where I don't want it to go. So sacrifice a bit of skin. Here's just the tip of the needle file there. That shape right. Coming off the back of my finger. Finger will grow back. Okay. Again, like most of this work, if the finished if at the end of each step it looks attractive, it means you've probably done a good job. And so that's what I really am aiming for here. And everything being uniform means I can quite easily that way judge it and tell that the bottom here of these bevels is nice and sharp. As you can see, that has provided a nice, sharp, tight area to lock in. See, because I put these little bevels on the outermost tips nice and with a big flat file, and now coming into the little dips with the needle file, and I know that the angle I'm creating in the little dips now corresponds to these if I get a nice even parallel line where they intersect. So it's a little guide. I'm also watching this edge here. I need to come over here. So I maintain the angle. I should then also be aiming for that same thickness. Then I know that this plane I'm putting in here corresponds with these angles, and I'll reach the point at the same time. And so that bevel is maintained, the angle of the bevel is maintained even as it ripples along. It's quite a tricky little exercise to get just so. And it's obviously not essential that it's been mechanically perfect for the actual purposes of inlay, but it is a good exercise. And it's a good discipline to achieve. Sometimes there will be times when you really do need it to be mechanically perfect. And if you can do it, then that's good. If you can't, you're at the mercy, or you're limited by your inability, or your lack of mastery of your craft, which means as an artist, you can't be as expressive as perhaps you'd like. And this is why ultimately, if you're a shit craftsperson, you're never going to attain any degree of real expressiveness. So you will always be handicapped. It's a bit like a pianist who can't play all the notes. And again, as I said, if the result of each step looks attractive, looks pretty, you've probably done a reasonable job.
because then you can stop work and go, okay, that part's well done. And you can come back to the work when next you're ready and feel encouraged by the fact that you've worked thus far to the best of your ability. Each step is the most important step. So that's that. I'm just going to get rid of that bird ever so lightly. And that, my friends, is a ginkgo leaf prepared for inlay. Okay. I think the next few episodes we're going to have to concentrate on the tools. So I hope that has been informative and instructive thus far. Don't forget to check the link out in the description below. There's a more detailed filing exercise and expose of the hand file, half-round hand file. All right, that's all for now. I'll see you next time.